we decided on this idea about like sharing our experiences with a little bit more behind the scenes, a little bit more about our life, kind of to so you can guys, many of you know us, but many of you don't. So we just want to kind of show you maybe a different side of us, maybe.
We're not going to do daily vlogs or videos and stuff because we have our business and our kids. It's more like our experience through the fencing and what we learned, and hopefully what we share is going to help you, whether you're a fencing coach, whether you're an athlete, whether you're just somebody who wants to start a business. I don't know. We haven't decided for sure what we exactly going to share, but it's going to be definitely athletes, success, fencing related, sports related. And maybe relationships
again,
too.
Yes, and again, the way we see it through our own life, through our own eyes, like how do we experience it? And again, what do we think about it? Also, we'll talk about like what our experiences are, like how we started fencing, why fencing, the benefits we had with fencing, what we learned through fencing, what we teach through fencing, like places we visited through fencing.
Yeah, there'll be a lot of videos coming
up. Fun things we do with fencing. Again, the ups and downs of fencing. Again, the...
And the mindset.
The dreading. Yeah. Again, the practices and how to, again, like the mindset of the fencer. Again, it's a lot of things that we can talk about. And again, we'll ask you and see what you want to... find out more and learn from us or find out about us, and then we're gonna go ahead and share it with you.
So today we're gonna talk about how we started fencing. This is something that of course everybody's asking us since we're fencing coaches. We've been asked whether we've been an athlete. Yes, we have. I started fencing when I was 10 years old. I fenced foil and I signed up myself because back in the day, so both of us are from Bulgaria, if you guys don't know, back in the days, you were able to walk into any kind of gym and any sports club and sign yourself. You didn't need the parents' permission because it was subsidized by the government. So I had a friend of mine, I was playing outside with our friends, we were little, and she came with a medal on her neck, and I remember I was asking her, what are you doing? Where did you come from? And she said, I came from a fencing tournament. I got a bronze medal. I don't remember. I think it was a bronze medal. And I said, well, you fence? And I've never really knew anything about the sport at that time. So the next day, I went with her to the practice. I signed myself up. I didn't even know pretty much what I'm signing myself for. And I've done many sports. And I, for me, I keep interest as long as I'm competing. If I'm not competing, it's not fun anymore. So then I signed myself up, I went home and I told my parents I signed up for fencing. My dad was happy. My mom was like, what is this? And she's like, no, tomorrow you're going to go and you're going to tell them you made a mistake. And I'm like, I didn't make a mistake. So long story short, a couple months later, my mom saw how much I loved it and I had passion for it. And I started competing and yeah. And then I'm going to continue after that when I went to high school so Chris can start his childhood beginning of fencing.
Well, for me again, my dad was a national coach for Sabre when I was a kid, and he would travel a lot, but for me that only meant like different presents, gift, more toys for me, fancy chocolate. Back in the communism times where only sport would kind of give you the opportunity to leave the country and see the Western world. So that was for me as a child. But then in general, I was very active since I was a child. So I would do a lot of different sports. And pretty much every summer, I would dedicate 3 months of like the off time of school to like different sports and get to learn. We would do a lot of table tennis in the backyard of the neighborhood, and we'll do a lot of soccer in the local school. So I'll do basketball, volleyball. I really tried like lots of different things, and my kind of passion when I was growing up was soccer. So I've tried in two different soccer academies, and I tried different positions. I ended up as a goalie at the very end, but then that was the end of it. I mean, my dad had a lot of good friends that would kind of give me a push, so to say, and give me a chance, but then in the end it was just say they would be pretty honest, and like my dad is most of the time, he was like, it's just not for you, buddy, not for you, just try a different sport. So then one day we were in the plane in the backyard with one of my friends, and we never really talked about like the competitive side, because all of us were pretty competitive, we would do a lot of games and stuff, but finally we kind of started playing with some sticks in the backyard, and we were kind of going through different ideas. Maybe I was kind of at the end of middle school, and up until that point I was still kind of doing soccer a little bit here and there, but we would start playing with some sticks, and then for some reason we had a mandatory army service in Bulgaria back at the time, so if you didn't have the college degree, then you would have to do 9 months, and if you had like the college degree, then you have to do 6 months of service. But then the getaway for me was like, oh wait a second, so there is a sports army, and that's what kind of what my dad did when he was in his 90s and 20 when he was 19 or 20 years old, and back then the service was 2 years. So, but long story short, I was going through my mind, okay, wait a second, I like fighting with sticks, and then there is sports army, so why not, let me just go ahead and give it a shot. And actually my friend's uncle, he was actually the coach for the cadet and the junior team back in Bulgaria in Sofia, and it was very convenient because my elementary school, my high school, the practice, everything was maybe like a mile distance from each other, so it was really convenient. I mean, I always had access to sports and to be able to maybe bike to school, get one bus stop to practice. It was very, very convenient. I mean, and again, long story short, I started, I signed up, I did footwork for, I always repeat this to everyone, it's like I did footwork maybe 2 to 3 months before I was able to touch a saber. So you really, that's how we call it, the basics and the sorting process. Like if you can kind of get used to being, I mean, if you push through the bottomness of repeating the same thing over and over until you get used to it and you get the mechanics of it, then okay, then you're good to go. Then we can actually train you more. And I always laugh with this with Tseti that in the US it's a little bit more different, where we can really have you do footwork only like for 3 months before you touch a saber, because then nobody would want to do it.
They after lose this. Their interest.
So I started again. I started this with my friend and his uncle. I went through the footwork. I had a lot of one of the coaches that actually coached us, and we do the physical, the conditioning, and then the footwork was, he's actually the Bulgarian national coach right now. He was back in the army back then, so he was doing the sports army, so that was like, oh, okay, they're in the army, they're here, they're teaching us, so this is good. And that's how it all started. I think 6 months in, or maybe 9 months in, my dad wasn't a national coach then, at that time, when I started, and but he started giving me lessons, and a lot of lessons. I would get lessons like pretty much 3 to 4 times a week, and then that's in the afternoon, and then I would have my practices after that, like for 2 hours, and I can go in the morning and do practices for 2 hours. So I really enjoyed fencing, and I really pushed myself to do as much schoolwork as possible, like to be able to go to practice. I mean, there was only maybe one occasion where I got a bad, very bad grade. I still remember biology, and then I told my dad. He actually became a jeweler at that time, and I just went into his shop and I was like, say, hey dad, I got an F in biology. He was like, oh, you're not gonna go to practice then you're grounded, you're just staying home. And then that really motivated me to prove that I can do better. That was, I think, freshman of high school. So then the next day immediately I would get up and usually in Bulgaria where it works, you can actually volunteer to get
to be tested.
To get evaluated. And then I went up in front of the whole class. That's how it worked.
That's how it is in Bulgaria. You don't
and
do tests.
You go in front of the whole class and he tells you, he asks you one question from whatever was every single like lesson you learned through the last 3 months. And he asks you one question. If you're able to give the full details, then you get rewarded. So I did it and I improved it. And then the very next day I was back on to practices. So from this point on, I learned my lesson to manage my time, to really get my schoolwork done. And then I would go and do everything I can in practice. But again, that's how for many years, I think that it took maybe a year and a half until I worked with my dad to see some improvement and to really kind of grow this passion for fencing and learning to manage again the losses from this point on in fencing. But that's really how it started. I mean, I really like the traveling aspect of fencing, and fencing took me to a lot of places. And one of the highlights was I was able to compete at the Cadet World Championships in South Bend, Indiana, in the United States. So I was feeling like the star in my high school, like being able to. I went through the interview process of getting visa for the United States and then coming here. And from that point on, my dad was actually international referee for many years. He refereed in the 2000 Sydney Olympics. And actually, I went there as an athlete, and he went there as a referee. And from this point on, I told my dad that, you know, like United States, this felt like something that's
it was right
for me. It was, felt right for me. So I really pushed him after that to
move
to move here, and kind of it's very difficult to really kind of leave everything behind, and you gotta make a lot of sacrifices in order to kind of to make it. And again, my mom kind of was left behind in Bulgaria, or kind of she didn't want to do it, but me and my dad left and we started our journey here like a year after he came after South Bend. Then I finished my high school, I finished my mandatory sports army, so to speak. And my sports army luckily was in Plovdiv, where Tetsi is from, so I was very happy that I was able to actually train and go out pretty much throughout the week and go and train and be with her and her family as well. So it was overall experience that taught me a lot and helped me grow as a person.
My story is a little bit different than Chris, because I didn't have the parent or somebody super close to me that to train me and kind of believe in me. So for me, it was a constant belief that I can do something big out of it. Of course, I wanted to be a world champion. Everybody that starts fencing wants to be. Everybody that's competing wants to be. Everybody's thinking about Olympics and this and that. But my case was extremely like, I don't think there's a day I had where people weren't telling me, you should stop this. Doesn't make sense. You're wasting your time. Your sport is not popular. You're not going to be successful and so on and so forth. But I kept going. As of lessons, it was funny when Chris said that he was getting like 3-4 lessons per week. I don't think I was getting, I probably got one lesson when I started very first, like a week or so. And I was told from the coach, I'll be a world champion. Of course, that's what they were telling everybody. And the next thing you know, probably a year later, I might have had a 5-minute. I don't remember having lessons. First, I was a foil fencer for 4 years. I was national champion. I was good. I was good at foil. So then 4 years later, I was having like big dreams. We were going to the Balkan Games and stuff. And all of a sudden, my coach is quitting and I have no options. Either I switch to saber or either I quit. And quitting wasn't an option for me because I absolutely love the sport. I couldn't convince myself to do épée because I just don't have the passion for it. Épée is just a little bit different. Foil was a little bit more aggressive. And then saber was very aggressive. And I was like, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if it's going to fit my personality. And then I switched to saber. I was convinced by one of the saber coaches in the other club in my city to switch to saber so I can travel the world. And I knew that this is a deal we're making, because when you're winning in Bulgaria, national championship or whatever, the fencing clubs are getting subsidized by the federation, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they make money. So, of course, why would this coach not say, hey, you can keep fencing Sabre. I was still winning every tournament in Sabre for so many years. And he makes money and I'm traveling. That was my dream, to travel. The only downside of that was that I was literally not even close to the level that the international fencers had, because I didn't have a good preparation. It's not like I was lazy to go to practice. It was nobody there to train me. So I was going by myself. There was a story where I was telling our kids in the club, my mom had a major surgery, life-threatening surgery, when I was younger, and I was already fencing foil. I was still fencing foil. So it was a couple weeks after she had the surgery, she came with me to the fencing club. I dressed her up with the bulkiest stuff I could find there so I can poke her and she can move around so I can practice. I don't think there was anybody in that club that trained more than me and wanting to be successful more than me. But it was kind of sad because she didn't have any support from anybody and nobody really believed you can make it, like, big. So I was national champion, but that wasn't enough for me. I wanted to make something bigger. So my mom signed me for a sports school. And in Bulgaria, the sports school is, you have all these athletes, of course. And we had school for a couple hours. We have a couple classes in the morning for 3 hours. And then we have 2 hour practice. Then you go for lunch with the whole school. Then you have 4 or 5 hours of classes again and 2 more hours practice at night. So I was going to all my practices. I wasn't skipping practices. Even though it was me and somebody else, I was just going there, working, training. When it was cold, it was freezing in the fencing club. It was a fencing club. When it was hot, it was super hot. There was no air conditioning, no heaters, nothing. So getting injured is extremely likely. And that was it. And then I was pushing through the days and lives, and I was dreaming of, like, the normal practices. I'm like, how is it so hard for somebody who wanting to compete so bad, giving everything they have, to find the person to train them? And I know a lot of people are saying, well, we didn't have the money in the club at the time. Those are excuses, because me and Chris are doing everything in our power to help our fencers. And if I see somebody that not being able to afford it, but wanting to train so bad, we will find a way to help this kid. And at that time, nobody was able to help me. So my uncle sometimes was giving my parents to pay for a tournament or so. And that was pretty much the short story. There's so much that probably I'll share on the videos. Just the struggles and how I was overcoming them. But the bottom line is, like, I don't think anybody believed in me more than I do, in a sense of, like, success. And whether that success wasn't happening, like me becoming a world champion, but I feel like it was a different purpose. I struggled. I learned so much that we projected now to our fencers. And I think I relive my dream every time they reach their milestone or success or with the medals. And I feel like, maybe, you know, it was worth it. First I was like, why is this happening? But now I kind of have the answer. So I wouldn't change it for anything. But I think we're going to have probably some video that is more broad. And we traveled the world. We met with Chris, but this is going to be another video that's coming up. And the experiences are unbelievable. I wouldn't change anything, and the lessons I learned. And one thing I want to clarify is, when we say sometimes with him that we try a lot of sports and then we sign up for fencing, it doesn't mean that we sucked at the other sports. I think it's more like you didn't find the love, because for fencing, you need to be athletic, you need to be fast, you need to be smart, because fencing is like a physical chess. You have to kind of set up the situations and, you know, all those kind of details, which if you're a fencer, you know what we're talking about. If you're not a fencer, we might have another video for that. But yeah, I wouldn't change it for the world. And that's pretty much how I start fencing.
Well, I mean, just to sum it up, I mean, we were pretty lucky that, again, we are part of fencing. This is...
Absolutely.
Fencing is really extraordinary in terms of the possibilities, the opportunities, that the community, like, it's, fencing is really, I would say, a small community. It's like, it's, you think a lot of fencers are doing it, but again, once once you start traveling, once you go to competitions, you get to know. It's very exciting. I mean, it's different. Like, I really can't see myself being in an office all day. And it's now kind of through COVID, it's a little bit different situation where it's like the repetition or getting to be on the Zoom over and over and over. It's like you try to get creative, but again,
it's getting old.
The end game again is like, it's, we really want to get back out there and again travel with our fencers, meet with our friends, with our colleagues, and it's, we go through the ups and downs and the winning and the losses, but yeah, then at the end it's like,
it's what you love.
one big
dysfunctional family
family and it's again, sometimes you win, sometimes you lose, and it's, you learn from it and you move on. I mean, life goes on. It's like, as I say, it is what it is. You can really dig. Again, we're going to have a different post about how to manage again school and fencing and how to, again, how everything is, I don't know how you say roses and how everything is nice
rainbows
and great
and, rainbows and unicorns
when you're winning. And then when you start losing, all your world is crumbling and school's crumbling. And so we're going to have a
Another topic
where,
because we went through that with almost every single fencer.
Yes, I'll never forget those
moments.
Those little moments, little experiences that kind of they serve as a key to what you're gonna do in the future.
It's like, and it's,
you kind of put on the spot to make a choice, and whether it's that choice made big difference at the very end.
Yeah, so thank you for watching our video. Subscribe. We sound like YouTubers.
So we just started our YouTube journey.
Oh my god! Okay?
So again, it's
maybe COVID not that bad.
It's not a big deal. Now we have a little bit more time on our hands. I don't see,
because we don't have usually time.
I think there is like 2 to 3 months more of us kind of getting to do more of this.
The little one is coming, so we gotta cut it short.
The kids are starting school in a couple of days, so it's gonna get hectic. Maybe you'll get to see them every now and then.
So thank you for watching, and we'll see you guys later.